Todd McTeague.
Instead of the
actual Easter egg hunt. And so if anybody wanted to donate for that, we normally do candy. But if this year, if you just wanted to give $1, $5, whatever, we're just going to have some prizes and do a real fun little scavenger hunt for the kids. If it is nice outside, we'll be outside for that. And if it is not, we'll just come inside for it. So either way, we're going to have a great time with it. And also, if you do not receive a monthly newsletter, just get with me after church if I don't have your address or if you have moved and I need your current address. And let's see, we have Tamika Jones, who I think you're getting treatment for your vertigo.
Yes.
Okay. We need to keep her in prayer. Sandy Ross, I talked with them last week, and Sandy is home.
Okay.
She's doing a little better, so we just need to keep her in prayer.
Awesome.
Also, just Barbara Tavenero and Michelle Thomas and the Duran family and the Sauer family as well. We need to pray for our Lighthouse leadership and growth. That needs to be our constant prayer on that. Connie Wetzel has a doctor's appointment tomorrow with some lab results. We need to keep her in prayer. And also, our brother Steve Potts is not feeling well this morning, so we could just say a prayer for him also. If the praise team wanted to come up and just pray, and get started. I'm going to read from Psalm 150. And it says, praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and lyre. Sorry, guys, I don't can't read that word. Praise him with timbrel and dancing. Praise him with the strings and pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
We'll just say a prayer. Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for everybody that has joined us in the sanctuary, and we thank you for everybody who's joined us online, Lord. We ask that you just give the word, Father, and that we may receive it. We ask that you keep us safe and protected, Father, throughout the week. We ask that you just touch our hearts and prepare us for communion. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
But there's also one more thing. We have two special birthdays this week. We have Lisa, who is on the 17th. And we have our pastor Scott, who is on the 19th. So we wanted to sing happy birthday to them.
What? Yep. Did you say she was 17?
Yes.
Yes.
So we'll have Justice lead in happy birthday.
We appreciate you guys.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Oh, wow.
Happy birthday.
Ready? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Scott and Lisa. Happy birthday.
I'm still older. It's okay. Don't ask her how old I am. She is. Thank you so much. No worries.
It's not bad.
Okay,
man. Will everybody please stand? If you can.
Accepted, you are condemned. Hallelujah.
God raised him. Amen.
My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save.
stones. You know, as we're singing that song, I got a feeling that some of us are singing it like we have a hill to move. Some of us sing like, I got to move some mountains. But the reality is, we got some mountains to move. Are you with me? We need to sing that song like, God took away this mountain. He's a conqueror. He's greater than. And we're singing like little molehills. We got some mountains to be moved. Come on, are you with me?
Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
We open our eyes and see. Open the eyes of our hearts. At the end of the day, in Ecclesiastes 12, he says, I found out in life the basic principles to fear God and keep His commandments. You know why he said that? Because he knows God's mighty to save. Hey, he's greater. I feel this is a word for somebody. He's greater than what you're facing. And our next song is going to be "In Christ Alone." That's the answer. Some of you have been looking everywhere else. I'm telling you right here, right now, He's the way, the truth, and the life.
Yes.
No one, nobody comes to the Father but by Him.
Yes. Jesus Christ.
Amen. In Christ alone.
Yes.
Satan is a liar. Did you know that? Did you know he'll lie to you? And he loves to tell you lies and not to try to make you feel defeated, discouraged. But I want to tell you, you are a winner in Jesus' name. Thank you, Adam. Thank you very much. Well, today we'll be continuing our series entitled Let's Talk, and how to overcome temptation. How to overcome temptation. Continuing James, you may turn to James. We talked last week about quite a few things. One of them is that issues to the church is not something new. Did you know that? Because the church consists of people like you and me. So the books that whether it be Corinthians, Galatians, James, they're written to encourage us and to teach us to how to be overcomers and to serve a risen Savior. Now in James chapter 1, it says, I'll be picking up actually in verse number 9. James 1 verse 9. Let the lowly brother glory in his exaltation, but the rich in his humiliation. Because as a flower of the field he will pass away, for no sooner has the sun risen with a burning heat than it withers the grass. A flower falls and its beautiful fragrance perishes, so the rich man will also fade away his pursuits. Later in our study, we'll talk about that, even in James 2, even about the sin of favoritism. We'll talk about the difference between a rich man and a poor man and how we treat them. But we'll talk about that a little later. Let's pick up on verse number 12. It says, blessed is the man who endures temptation. For when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. It's promised to those who love him. Verse 13. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil.
Right.
You ever heard the phrase, the devil made me do it? Well, we'll talk about that a little later, actually. Nor does he, speaking of God himself, tempt anyone. God does not tempt you to sin.
That's right.
He does not. But each one is tempted when he's drawn away by his own desires and enticed by his own desires.
Uh-oh.
Then when desire is conceived, it gives birth to sin.
Amen.
And sin, when it's full grown, brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my brethren, my beloved brethren, for every good and perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. Of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of his creatures.
Right.
There's a video, if it's okay, I'd like for you to watch just a little video that I think you'll find comical, but there's so much truth to it.
Have it now or you can wait.
Alright, so I'm going to leave and then I'll come back, okay? So you can either eat it right now or you can wait. Either way, okay? Okay. How'd you do? Did you do good? You did? You wanted to eat it, didn't you?
Yeah.
So that's why I'll give you another one?
Okay.
I can have both. You need them.
Temptation. So real, isn't it? So real. And we're all in this together. And you can see even the video that said you can be blessed if you'll wait. And they just so much wanted what they had right before them. And I love their expressions. Kids will just tell you just everything. They're so honest, right? And we're honest too. We're in the same boat. Temptation. How to overcome temptation. So reality is this. Now, I promised that during the series I sit down for the most part, so I'm going to try. So, temptation is inevitable. It's inevitable. No one escapes it. Not even Christ escaped it. And you read those references I have before you in Hebrews and Corinthians. Even Christ was tempted. Okay? Yielding to temptation is sin.
Right.
It's when you yield. We're all tempted. Christ was tempted, but he did not yield. Yielding is sin. Temptation is also not just a single event, but a process involving four different stages. You ready? Four different stages. One is desire. I want it. Desire. Secondly, deception. Thirdly, disobedience. And the fourth and final one is death itself.
Right.
Okay? So let's talk about the word desire. Now, the children's church has been dismissed. We can talk about some heavier stuff, right? And if we can't, then we're just children ourselves. So anyway, desire, the word lust means any kind of desire, not necessarily sexual passion. Now, we think of lust, or a desire, rather, as only sexual passion, but it's actually multifaceted.
Right.
The normal desires of life were given to us by God, and of themselves are not sinful.
Right.
God gave you desires, and within his godly biblical parameters, they are a blessing. It's when we satisfy these desires in ways outside of God's will, that's when we get in trouble.
Amen.
Now, I do want to tell you that I can make my outline readily available to you. I see some of you taking notes. That's great. But I can get that to you if you wish. So after service, we can make copies. If you want to look these up yourself, I'd be more than happy to get that to you. But it's when we get outside of God's will. Now, just a reminder, within God's will, desires in his will, in his parameters, are godly. He gave you those. It's when we yield and go outside his will, that's when sin happens.
Right.
Now, eating is normal. Eating is normal. Gluttony is sin. We don't talk much about gluttony, by the way. It's because we like it too much, probably. Oh, come on, we're in this together. So, sleep is normal. Laziness is sin. Okay? Marriage should be honored by all, and the marriage bed kept pure. For God will judge the adulterer and the sexually immoral. It says in Hebrews 13:4. So, my friend, I tell you, desire for even the opposite sex within the godly parameters of marriage is biblical. God made you that way. So that's a normal desire, and it's ours as a church to teach about godly principles so that you can yield to his desires in his will. Outside of that is where we get into big trouble. It's called sin.
Right.
Parents, you need to teach your kids it's normal to have desires that God gave you. But outside his perimeters is where sin occurs. And ultimately, deception and even death.
Amen.
Right.
Deception. No temptation appears as temptation. It doesn't usually appear that way. It seems more alluring than it really is. Temptation always carries with it some bait that appeals to our natural desires. The bait not only attracts us, but it also hides the fact that yielding to desire will eventually bring sorrow and punishment.
Right.
See, Satan knows how you're made up. He knows how we're made. He knows how God made you. And so he knows even Scripture. Do you know that Satan can quote Scripture?
Yes.
So he knows what God's parameters are. He baits you to step out of those parameters.
Right.
And a wise person is a person who knows what God's principles are, then you are in God's will. A wise person also says, I refuse to take that bait. Because I know where it leads me. That's what we're going to teach today about being wise in temptation and how to overcome it. I want to talk a bit about a person named David. You ever heard of him?
Yeah.
King David in Scripture, a man after God's own heart. I read this Scripture repeatedly, and even this morning, and my heart breaks as I read this Scripture. And you can read it in 2 Samuel chapters 11 and 12. And I encourage you to read that on your own. Here's a man after God's own heart. A man that had a direct, powerful relationship with God. And it says in that Scripture, during the season of the battles of the kings, typically the king would go out to battle with his soldiers. But David stayed behind for whatever reason. He stayed behind. He really should have been doing what he was supposed to do.
Right.
But he deviated from that. That's the first thing, my friend. Do what God calls you to do.
Excuse me.
Do what God calls you to do. Some of you may be sitting there knowing God's called you to do something and you're refraining from doing it, and you're going to find yourself setting yourself up for the bait.
Amen.
Right.
So David, his first mistake, he didn't do what God... Just one moment. Anyone else had allergies just coming up? Okay. So you're with me on that.
Yeah.
And when I lead singing and preach, my voice struggles just a bit, okay? All right. So David was a man after God's own heart. He didn't do what God wanted him to do. He stayed back behind. And one day he's leisurely on top of his big castle overlooking his kingdom, and you know the story. And he looks down and he sees this woman bathing.
Amen.
And how many of you know her name? Come on, say it.
Bathsheba.
You can remember that because bath, it just seems to fit so well, right? That's why, hey, we're visual minded people. That's why you remember. Which, by the way, another little thing, I'm just really struggling with my mics today. How about this? Can I just do that? There. How about that? All right, this one's going to tag along behind me. So the reality is that Bathsheba, and I was going to give you another tip. Can anyone of you Bible scholars remember the name of the person that fell out of the window when Paul preached at midnight in Acts 20, verse 7? Do you remember that? Well, his name, you'll never forget it again. You ready? His name was Eutychus. And you know how you're going to remember that? Eutychus too, if I preach till midnight. Then you'll never forget it again. You'll remember that forever, okay? I bet you if I ask the same question next week, you're going to die, Eutychus! Because you'll remember that. See how we are? So David actually looked and saw Bathsheba bathing. Bathsheba was not his wife.
Amen.
He looked elsewhere. He looked at another man's wife, which was the first thing he should have done. He should have turned around. Now, he saw her. He admired her beauty, and that's instinctive.
Right.
Come on, that's instinctive.
Right.
But when he dwelled and stayed longer and infatuated, that's where he sinned. Come on, with you. Right. Today's world, we're exposed to so many things on the internet and what have you. And we need to turn away from it. Turn it off.
Yes.
Because that's a natural desire that God gave you that Satan is baiting you to step out of it.
Right.
So you'd be wise to turn it off.
Yes.
Okay? So we know that David had looked at another man's wife and he infatuated. This is where the sin began. And then he brought her in. He's the king. He has power. And he had her brought in. And he had relations with her. Now, see the development of temptation, how it went. A natural desire that God gave him now is outside of God's will.
Right.
And so she came into him because he's the king. She has to. Isn't that terrible to think of it that way? She came into him and he had relations with her. And then he sent her away. And then down the line, you can read this yourself, a little time elapsed while her husband is fighting David's war.
Amen.
Uriah is fighting David's war. She sends word to him. Can you imagine this knock like this? King David, I sent word, I'm pregnant. Can you imagine how he felt? Imagine he knew it was wrong. So, you know, we strong Christians, you know, we think, I blew it, so the first thing David's going to do is ask for forgiveness, because that's what I would do. Or would you? Because what David did was that this went worse. So now he started plotting. How can I fix this? And quite honestly, in today's world, abortion is one of the top things that comes to people's minds. To kill the baby. Now, you tell me. Now, this message isn't about abortion necessarily, but I will bring this in. That becomes a mixed thing that even, quite honestly, some Christian parents have paid for their daughter to have an abortion because they think that fixes the issue. The issue happened back here. And the smart believer falls on her face and says, I am sorry, because this is a path of sin. And when no one's judging anyone, I realized this years ago that when you're talking, just because you're talking in a church, don't assume someone hasn't had an abortion.
Amen.
And I'm not here to judge you. I'm here to tell you there was repentance in the name of Jesus Christ.
Right.
Come on, I'm with you.
Yes.
So we know that as a result of that, David starts concocting a story or trying to get this out. So he sent word and had Uriah brought back from the battle he was supposed to be fighting. And brought him in and said, here, come and relax. You're a great guy. I'm paraphrasing. You can read the story. You're a great guy. Come on in. And go to your wife. Sleep with her. Because David knew she was pregnant. Hoping that he would. And then, phew, this fixes the problem. They didn't have DNA samples back then. They didn't have all these things like that. Well, Uriah, being the faithful soldier, wouldn't even go into his house with his wife. He went in with the slaves, the servants, and slept with them. And when David called him in the next day, he said, why didn't you go into your wife? He said, because my fellow soldiers are fighting a fight out there, sleeping in the field. How can I go into my wife? This is a man of integrity. Yes. This is a man of integrity. And so as a result of that, David said, as you look through the series, David, after man after God's own heart, even concocted and got some alcohol involved. And even got him drunk. Thinking that he would get so intoxicated, he would inevitably go into his wife. Uriah, being a man of integrity, did not. So David now is saying, this is how deep it's going. Mind you, again, a man after God's own heart. And so now he says, what can I do? He won't go into his wife. His wife is pregnant with my child. So he said, okay, Josiah, he said, you're a general in my army. I'm sending Uriah to you. This is how bad it goes. I'm sending Uriah to you. And I want you to put him on the front lines. And I want you to put him in the heat of the battle that I should be fighting. But I want him to fight for me. And I want you to, it seems so bad, he says, I want you to have your men pull back. Just so he can be killed. So the general did just that, and Uriah was killed. So David now has a situation with Bathsheba, she's pregnant, and Uriah now, he's a murderer now. Yep. He killed the husband, but he thinks it's all good. No one knows. Did you know something? God knows.
Amen.
Yes.
God knows what you've done. And for a few moments here, I want you to feel conviction, because I know I'm speaking to a house that some of you can relate in some way, shape, or form. In a few moments, I'm going to tell you where victory lies. Because I'm not here to judge. I'm here to relay God's word. Let the Holy Spirit do what he does best.
Yes.
So David thinks it's all good. But God sent a prophet to him. And as a result of that revelation, David realized God knew all along. Hey, God knows you very well.
Yes.
And when you look at a temptation, and when you look at something that God gave you a desire, hey, my friend, that's something God gave you. But a wise person is to say, I want to put that phone away from me because of what it's doing to me. I want to put that computer away from me because of what it's doing to me. I want to put this person that I'm just hanging with, but you know where it's going. You know where it's going.
Amen.
You need to stop it right now and say, in the name of Jesus, I declare victory over this desire.
Right.
Because the desire God gave you is now taken out of control.
Mm-hmm.
And the reality is, desire, next thing it becomes deception. Deception. And then it becomes disobedience. In 1 Corinthians 10:12, it says this. 10:13 rather, I'm sorry. 10:12, back up one. There we go. It says in 1 Corinthians 10:12, therefore, let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he falls.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you, so I got to stand up a little bit here. Hey, church, we're not alone.
Amen.
A pastor can fall too. A king can fall too. A man or woman after God's heart can fall too. So this message applies to all of us, and that scripture is telling us, my friend, be very careful. Realize what God's given you, but don't let it go out of bounds because you think you stand. How many times have preachers preached from the pulpit while doing a simple relationship on the side?
Amen.
The sooner that we can deal with the big evil, the better off we will be. Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
Take heed lest you fall. Let me go to the next scripture. It's in verse 13, actually, is what it says. In verse 13, it says, no temptation has overtaken you except is common to man.
Yes.
But God is faithful.
Yes.
He's faithful. Who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able.
Yes.
But with the temptation, with it, will also make the way of escape.
Yes.
That you may be able to bear it. Let's review just a moment, because if you're like me, we need to talk a little bit here. We're in this together, saints.
Yeah.
We are people after God's own heart.
Yeah.
And the reality is that we found out by Scripture, there's not a one of us immune to taking the bait.
Right. Yeah.
To taking the bait. But God makes us a promise. And one thing I've learned in my life is when God promises it, you can bank on it.
Yes.
Can I know that?
Amen.
You can bank on it. So the reality says, you can't use the excuse, the devil made me do it.
Right.
He may have definitely had a part in it, but he did not make you do it.
Right.
You saw the bait, and you took the bait.
Right.
And now you're in hook, line, and sinker.
Yep.
The devil didn't make you do it. As a matter of fact, the reality is this, God even provided you a way out.
Yes.
That's a promise.
Yes, it is.
But Pastor, you don't understand. I really like this particular movie. I know it's got a lot of doo-doo in it. And I know it's got a lot of other things. And, you know, my friend, I'm going to tell you, that pollutant that's in there, Satan plants that there, and he will prey, P-R-E-Y, on your natural desires.
Right.
See, you have a natural desire, and so you'll gravitate toward that. And he knows it. And if he can pull you out, grab my hand, if he can pull you out of the desire and pull you out of his will, now you're stepping in uncharted ground. You're stepping in ground that's outside of God's will. And some of us today are right there and out of God's will. disobedience. So much for sitting down, right? Desire conceives a method for taking the bait. The will approves and acts in the result of sin. Christian living is the matter of will, not feelings. In other words, learning God's word, hearing the message today, God is feeding your spirit, and you must discipline yourself to adhere to his will. Because if you base it on feelings, my friend, we can get way out there. Because you know why?
Right.
It says in Jeremiah 17:9, it says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? My friend, how much of people today are living their lives based on how they feel? Even churches, they'll say, I'm attending that church because it makes me feel good. Now, we are people that have natural feelings that God gave us. But is it biblically sound? Is it allowing the Spirit of God to move? Is it teaching true doctrine? Is it leading me down paths of righteousness? That's the church you want to seek out. That's love will love you enough to tell you the truth.
Amen.
Because my friend, if you want to follow your heart, that's what the world will tell you. How many marriages today, I'm getting close to home here, but I'm not here to judge or rebuke you. I'm just letting God apply it where God applies it. But how many marriages are broken because someone looked outside the will of God and started thinking the grass pasture or the greener on the other side?
There you go.
Hey, that's better there. The reality is that people are people. And Satan would love to bait you into doing something that is ungodly. And I'm not talking only marriage, because lust considers many different forms. It's actually many different forms. One I would say that I probably, as Christians that have been around the faith long, is judging. The danger of judging someone. I read the scripture, judge not that you be not judged, Matthew 7:1. Matter of fact, that's one of the most popular scriptures today. Do you know that? It used to be John 3:16, but now it's Matthew 7:1. Judge not that you be not judged. Because the world doesn't want to go to a church that's judging them.
Right.
You know, the reality, okay, you can read 1 Corinthians 5. You can read it, write it down. It talks about, Paul gives some parameters about when to judge.
Right.
When to judge. But that's another message itself. Our hearts can lead us astray. How about this? I want to buy this thing. I can't afford this thing. But I really want it. God, give me this thing. I'd really love to have this new car. I'd really love to have this new truck. I'd really love to have this new home. God, give it to me. He says, no. Boy, that's deep, wasn't it? He says, someday. But your heart says, oh, but God, my heart tells me, I really know I love that thing. So, you know, God still says, no. So what do? I want to follow my heart. After all, I feel like this is right. So you go and knock and go to the banker, and then you go to another banker because he says no, and you go find one that will. It's called creative financing. That's what it's called, creative financing. And you find one that will loan you. So now you got it. And you're really enjoying this. They go, oh, God, thank you. And he goes like, I didn't grant that blessing. And then you find out the vehicle gets dirty just like your other one, especially if you got a black one. I love black, but boy, it gets dirty, right? And it requires cleaning and maintenance just like the other one. And then that payment comes every month. Like, oh my word. And then life happens and I can't make the payment. And you say, God, why is this burden so much on me? I can't make these payments. God, what? Come on, God, bless me. Provide. He says, I said no. Come on, this is real stuff. Come on, right? I told you this is real stuff. When God says no, and our heart says yes, who do you follow? Follow the Word of God and His leading. Give back to... I read the scripture that says something like this. Those that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings of eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint. Those that wait on the Lord.
Yes.
Ultimately, temptation leads to disobedience and ultimately leads to death. it leads to death. Disobedience gives birth to death, not life. It may take years for the sin to mature, but when it does, the result will be death. You know, we live in a very, this is a very real stuff. David, as you study that out, later his children rebelled. They rebelled in a very terrible way, did terrible things. And because of the sin that David did, he couldn't even rebuke them. I mean, what's he going to say? Absalom? You're doing terrible. How dare you do that? I'm going to rebuke you. He'd say, but Dad, look what you've done. I know what you did. And what can you say? Let's get real with that. David blew it. You and I have blown it. Come on. A wise person is one that says, before this gets deeper, I'm stopping this right now. I'm going to confess my sin. If David would have confessed it and made it out there, oh, what the outturned outcome would have been totally different. His kids would have respected him. Yeah, Dad, but look at you. You're a man of integrity. You messed up, but you confessed it. And you said, God, forgive me, and I respect you, even in your mistakes. But how many parents are not willing to have that attitude? How many parents want to tell their kids how to live when they're not living right themselves? Come on, is that true now? Getting real close to home. I mean, this is home, quite honestly. My friend, we need to be wise about temptation. And realize those desires that you have are natural that God's given you. But my friend, you're wise when you keep those in biblical parameters and say, I'm sorry. So often, that's another thing about the internet. It has a tendency to take those desires and put them to exponentially put them out there. So now you have someone even way over there or over there you can talk with. Be careful, my friend. Be careful, my friend. James 1:14. This is in conclusion today. James 1:14, we read the scripture, it says, temptation comes from our own desires. When enticed, which enticed us and drag us away. These desires give birth to sinful actions. And when sin is allowed to grow, it gives birth to death. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life.
Yes.
In closing today, I know that this is very real stuff, and I'm not here condemning anybody. What I'm saying is, I'm giving you scriptural insight. Some of you need to stop some of the things you're doing. I'll just look up here. That's all right. Hey, we're in this together. Some of us need to stop some things we're doing. I wonder, husbands, this is getting real. If you were to turn your phones over to your wives and they looked into the history of your phone, would that make you uncomfortable? Wives? If your husbands were to look at who you've been talking to, have them review all your texts and the things you've been saying, would that make you uncomfortable? See, the reality is this. This is real stuff. It's so easy. Even when I do YouTube and I Google things, as I say, I don't know sometimes. But on YouTube, you can bring up things and that you're totally within biblical parameters, look at it, and all of a sudden something pops up. Come on, it's easy.
Oh yeah.
And that natural desire is to be enticed. Mm-hmm. You don't have to click it. You just clicked it. And then you did it once, and now it's, then all of a sudden YouTube now says, oh, I know how you think.
Yeah.
So now they send more. Well, is that not right? They send more. I've clicked it before. I'm being honest. Oh, Pastor. You don't know what it was, I'm going to tell you. I just think back to a long time ago, I clicked it, and I found out myself. All sorts of trash came up. And then what you do is like, well,
Nobody knows. It's my phone. And now it's wow. So you have a tendency that no one's going to know. No one's going to know. No one's going to know. And pretty soon you're going back and you go, oh, the history. Remove from history. Remove from history. Remove from history. And you can remove it from history and think that no one knows. But God still knows. You can't remove it from that history. And God loves you enough. It's not that he's there wanting to beat you up. It hurts his heart when you're going down the path. Because you've just taken what he gave you and you're taking it out of his parameters. And you're walking down a path of darkness. I just described a very real path to us today. Your kids, parents, grandkids are battling the same thing. I think it's wise, parents, grandparents, check your kids' history on their phones. I don't know how to do that. I can show you how to do that. Probably most of us, right? I think you should, because you need to guard them. You need to teach them that desire you have is God gave you. God gave you a desire for sex, for passion. He gave you a desire to succeed. That's how we live our life. And in godly parameters, it's beautiful. We need to teach our kids. And when you clip that, you're stepping out. And that path leads to darkness. How many people are out here, whatever the path has been, and they come to church and they say such things as, I just don't get that much of service anymore. Preaching isn't all that good. And I want to tell you what probably the majority of the time is. It's because you're out of God's will.
Amen.
And God can't touch you like he once did.
Amen.
Hey, this is real stuff. Come on. So next time you want to get on there and on Facebook or whatever, texting or whatever you do, and you want to talk about somebody, I want to tell you, that's out of God's will.
Right.
That's sin.
Right.
It's slander. Mm-hmm. It's all the, and so, but you don't understand. See, your heart is leading you down a path of darkness. You get back in God's will, and he'll shut your mouth. And he'll stop your fingers because you're under conviction.
Right.
Hey, this is real stuff, and this is today's stuff.
Amen.
This is today's stuff. I think we need to be more real. Pastors need to have a heart for the church and say, hey, we're in this together, and I'm not ignorant of these devices. But above whatever I do, you can't delete your history with God. Other than,
there you go.
God, forgive me.
Yes.
For what I said. Forgive me for what I did.
Yes.
Forgive me of where I looked and how I, where I did. Forgive me, Lord. In Galatians it says you still reap what you sow. But you, it's up to you to stop it.
Yes.
Do you know God forgives you instantly?
Yes.
God forgives you instantly. There's new life. Don't go back to the old path. Some of us need to take some extreme measures. If that means staying away from your phone for a month, do it. If that means you don't go on some of these social media because you need to get away from it, do it. Do what it takes. Your soul is on the line. Oh, you're not talking about me. I don't do that. I got it within. You know, one of the lies of Satan is this. I've got it under control. No, you don't. No, you don't. Control is in God's will. Anything outside of that is not in God's will. You are not in control. And Satan is now dictating your life. The sooner you get back in God's will, the better off you'll be. You may still reap what you've sown, but you are forgiven and on a new path.
Yes.
And today, here's where it turns, all right? There's hope for you. I just read your mail. I've read our mail. I've been real with you. It's time for a change. I've loved you enough to tell you you're on a path that's going to kill you.
Yes.
You're on a path that's going to tear you up.
Yes.
And Satan's going to spit you out. See, David didn't know the end. It just started with one simple look.
Right.
If he would have thought he would ever end up committing adultery, or if he would have thought he actually ended up killing the husband and then living a lie, if he would have thought that, do you think he'd ever gone down that path? Some of you are getting real close to that slippery slope. And who knows how far you're going to fall. None of us is immune. But here's the promise. With every temptation, God will provide a way out. He will provide it. Your excuse, "the devil made me do it," is a lie. He definitely fed it. He definitely said, how many of you, are you so bold to say, "I've got some weaknesses"? I've got some weaknesses. One time I was telling my daughter-in-law, I said, I've got some weaknesses. And she said to me, "What are they?" I'm not telling you. That's my weaknesses, and I'm not really proud of that. And how dare we? Maybe someone has a weakness with drinking or smoking or things like that. So we go, "It's not my problem. How dare you do that? How dare..." Hey, don't get... No. You've got some weaknesses too. We need to help each other, not look down on each other.
Amen.
This is a hospital that God provided to help you out of the mire, not to push you down deeper. A lot of churches are. Hey, my friend, we'd be wise to change your path. You'd be wise to just change it so your future can be in God's hands. The path that some of you are on is taking down a path of darkness, and we know where that goes. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, God, your scripture is so amazing, and you know us so well. Father, you've even said in your word that with every temptation, that you will provide a way out, knowing that we would be tempted. And God, we help us to teach us, God, Spirit of God, teach us about that we truly are tested by you, but we are not tempted by you. You can't teach it, tempt us for evil. And God, the reality is that within the sound of my voice, I know there are some that have fallen in, have taken the bait, and they've fallen prey to their temptation, and they're too embarrassed to admit it. God, I pray right now by your Spirit, not by anything, the preacher or anything like that, but by your Spirit, I pray, Lord, you bring revelation to where they are right now.
Yes.
And can they really say that they are in your will? Father, so many times we cry out, "God, fill me with your Spirit," but we've got a lot of pollutants in our life. God, I pray that you would teach us and convict us and make us miserable, even sick, the next time we are taking the bait and going down that path. With no one looking around. That's the last thing we want, people looking around. I just want to quickly, that God has touched your heart in some way, and you know that you are on that path in some way, and that the Holy Spirit has convicted you, and you're on that path, and you want to change. I want to pray for you. Would you quickly just put your hand up? No one else is looking, so I can see. Amen. I see a hand. Amen. I see a hand. Amen. I see hands. I see hands. Amen. This is a great day. This is the day.